sometimes things sound better than they actually are. Sweetbread is neither sweet nor bread. And hey, I like fruit, I like cake. So with a name like fruitcake, it's gotta be awesome, right? No, not awesome.
One of those things are deferred interest plans, which a lot of retailers continue to offer, but it's not as great of a deal as it might seem.
Analyst Jill Gonzalez is here to run down the results from WalletHub's 2020 deferred interest study. Let's start with the obvious. What is deferred interest?
Deferred interest typically happens on a store credit card or a store financing plan. Back in the old days when we went shopping in person, you would see those big signs that said special financing.
What sucks you in is the bold print that says 0%.
Say that you buy an $800 TV and you have 6 months of 0% deferred interest. That means you have 6 months to pay that off in total, all of the $800.
The catch is you can't miss a payment and you have to pay off the full $800 within the 6 month introductory period, or else you pay a higher interest on the entire $800.
If on the 7th month you even have $20 left over, because the interest was deferred, you're actually going to have to make payments on that entire $800 purchase just because you didn't pay it off before that introductory period was over.
So all that interest you thought you weren't going to pay lands on that card. And the interest rates on store cards can be steep.
The average APR on a store credit card right now is 28%. That is very high.
Okay, let's get to the study, which found that most people don't know what they're getting into.
74% of people don't understand how deferred interest works.
The fact that 3 out of 4 people don't get it isn't surprising.
In fact, that's what stores are banking on. They know that you don't understand how it works.
They're legally obligated to disclose the terms, but that doesn't mean they can't make it hard to understand.
They put all of the fine print there, but a lot of people don't read it. And a lot of times they word it in such a way that even if you do read it, it might not all click.
And it's not just the small print, it's the weird legalese.
I've been reading through these types of things for years now, and I still am kind of scratching my head at some way that they word these things.
Well, the experts at WalletHub explained the actual terms of these kinds of offers to the consumers they surveyed.
Over 60% of them said that process should be illegal.
Finally, keep in mind that some store cards are better than others. According to WalletHub, store cards offered by Home Depot and JCPenney score high on transparency, but the cards at Bed Bath & Beyond, K and West Elm, not so much.
So these things should probably be a last resort. I'm not saying that they're never an option, but they should only be an option if you have a for sure plan that you're paying it off in plenty of time, or at least by the time the introductory period ends.
If used properly, store cards can even be an asset.
A lot of them do give you 5% cash back, great ongoing rewards, or a pretty hefty initial cash back on your first purchase. Those can be actually great ideas if you need to finance a big purchase.
Avoiding special financing gotchas is at the top of the list.